How do we do it? They can actually two-part, an internal part, the implanted one, which is surgical implanted, it's actually just a microelectrode going through the cochlea where we will finally stimulate. And the external part, actually picks up the sound, processes and copies the sound by means of the processor, and then the COVID speech, if you want, goes through a transcutaneous telemetry link to the implanted part, where the spikes, electrical pulses are generated, which go down the microelectrode, which stimulates the cochlea, which internally elicits a response from the auditory nerve, and in this way, we manage actually to close the gap that exists in the auditory pathway. However, you can see down here the electronics of this, and they are pretty complicated. This is the internal part with the implanted part of the electrode array, this is the transcutaneous link electronics, and this is the external part. And in our community there is a drive to make this part of the implanted, which is totally implantable cochlea. Why would you need that? Because that would boost the confidence of CI users. It would relax actually the constraints as far as the everyday life is concerned. And there are also some technical advantages, particularly with respect to the transcutaneous link that is there. So our effort, and the effort of our excellent colleagues in the community, has been to make this totally implantable. How would we need to go about that? Well, you should actually model a segment of the cardiac membrane, and we wanted to model that in a biomimetic way. We did that by actually realizing 1-0 gamma filters, and we had we collaborated there with T. Clyon, the legendary figure in the auditory community, and they invite actually the students to go and check his website and model at the different contributions in different fields. He's here with his new book. So if we actually manage to mimic a segment of the cochlear membrane, then if we had a few of them, we could have the cochlear implant, if we had many of them, then we could start talking about biotic here processors. So 1-0 gamma filters can be viewed as a shortcut series of second-order responses. After 3 low pass, which, because we are after realizing a system like the year that has 110 degrees dynamic range, means that actually localizing centers are very good candidates for progressing the field, for making a difference there as far as performance is concerned. So we went and implemented this with Lotomay. However, for the 1-0 gamma filter response, we went with that because of 3 basic characteristics. We can control where the center frequency is, and we can control that electronically. We can control the gain with another single parameter. For those of you from technical background, you understand that you don't want to change 10 different parameters to achieve one thing. You would prefer simplicity. Simplicity leads to fastness. And we had another parameter that would control the take of these responses. All of that, when you compare with physiological responses, we were trying to mimic with electronics the physiological responses. If you actually compare now this particular filter against many other auditory filters and against a list of desired characteristics, you are going to see that they are one of the best. And on top, we could implement that with ultra-low power, low domain techniques, and go to the next step as far as technology progression for cochlear implants is concerned. So, we did it, and we wanted to control the gain. We realized the chip, 124 degrees dynamic range, we must be auditory range, 2.4 microwatt consumption. How much is 1 microwatt? You understand? 100 watt bulb can power up 100 million circuits that consume 1 microwatt. This is how small the microwatt is. And test it. Some people in the audience will identify this video. What we are going to see here is actually the robotic gain response. So here we have a very strong signal and we don't have a lot of gain. And now, gradually, we make the signal smaller and smaller and the gain should be increasing automatically. We are trying to mimic the physiological response of the cochlea. This one. Now we are going to see the lab. Smaller signal. There. The response becomes very narrow, high gain. And now we are going to put the initial signal, which was strong, and you are going to see the gain automatically adapting to something much, much smaller. We confirmed that we had done a very good job at mimicking the segment of the cochlear implant. We confirmed tubability, we confirmed linearity, and crucially, you're not going to find many results like this one. We actually confirmed internship variability, which meant that the circuit was robust. It would make sense to actually fabricate that. It was not one out of 20 systems worked. So we were ready. We were ready then to put all the biomimetic channels next to each other and actually build our proper processor. Cool. Then we had to face a bigger challenge, and the challenge is the following. If you imagine that you had two channels, one corresponding to one frequency, whether that is strong, then your body gain control is not going to amplify that. But if you have another one close to this that is weak, your body gain control will amplify that. So what you're actually doing, you are losing spectral contrast. And because you are losing spectral contrast, you are losing sensitivity. And when we talk about cochlear implants, we want the spectral contrast for cochlear implant users to be at least 6 to 8 dB higher than normal hearing. So we have to face another challenge there, perhaps a more difficult one than the previous one. Everything here is now in the lobotomy. Now, if you want to control the gain of the center, you look at the output of this particular channel.